slip you some Boogie We Will. For the Fringe FM, coming at you live from the middle of nowhere, the center of everywhere, here once again to give you yet another dose of conversational boogie. This is Shift Happens. Do follow us on Twitter over at Shift Happens Pod. You can follow me, Gigi, over at GigiRabbit1. You can follow Cortana over at Empress Cortana. Isn't that right, Cortana?
Very much so.
Fantastic. So, hope everybody had a good 4th of July last night, and hopefully, I figured most people would celebrate this weekend, but I guess most people considered last weekend the celebratory time. But
it's always a celebratory time where you are. Fireworks, yay!
Yeah,
tribal fireworks.
Man, so this year I went to the over there by the fountain where the ducks are and all that.
Yes.
And because last year we didn't, I think we just like stayed home, right, and just watched it from the backyard.
Yeah, we got drunk and watched it in the backyard.
Yeah, and so this year I decided to go out there, and I couldn't believe how many people were there. I mean, at least 2,000 or 3,000 people. Like, all of the grass area around that lake or pond, whatever you want to call it, all around. I walked around the whole thing, just absolutely filled with lawn chairs and people. But you know, it was all families and kids and stuff. So. Kind of cool, kind of whack, but
yeah, but it's kind of an alien concept to me, having grown up in California, where you know, home fireworks are legal, you know, whereas coming up to here in Washington, it was just like the weirdest things, like where are all the fireworks stands, like why, and it's like, oh, there's an ordinance like countywide or something that prevents people from having home fireworks. Not that it stopped the neighbors last night, that's for sure.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, a bunch of drunk people running around blowing things up might not be the safest thing of all time, but you know what?
But it's tradition.
Yeah, it's one of America's favorite pastimes, so
yes.
If you think you're going to stop that, especially on 4th of July, you got another thing coming. But yeah, that was fun. And then the most amazing part was after the fireworks were done, like, you know, went back inside, you know, we were at the American Grill, went back to the bar, like, had a beer or whatever, and then, like, I came back out just to, you know, I was going to go out and mingle. You know, like 45 minutes later, after the fireworks were done, and all of those thousands of people, gone, vanished. Nobody was out there. I've never seen a clearance like that anywhere in my life. It was just as amazing as how many people were there in the first place. It was like a Houdini trick or something. Just like,
I missed those steak sandwiches and the yam fries, and that place was really good.
Oh, yeah, you can never go wrong. With a good old American Grill. So, but anyway, so Stranger Things season 3.
Oh my God.
Yeah. So, okay, real quick, I've got a question, Cortana, because I was on, like, because before I started watching season 3, I was like, I was thinking, I wonder how this is going to go without Hopper. Because I thought at the end of season 2, I was like, pretty sure he died. Or
no, he's still around.
I mean, but why did I think that? Did he almost die at the end of season 2? And then I thought, like, maybe he got fired or something. But no, he was around, still a cop. I was like, what the hell was I thinking?
You know, it might be some, you know, Mandela effect thing. Because I honestly don't remember what happened at the very, very end of it. But I don't remember Hopper ever dying.
Yeah, it's weird. Yeah, I don't remember much either. Like, yeah, like, I think I need to go back and watch the first 2 seasons again, because I really don't remember, because that was a couple years ago when I saw those, but...
But I got to episode 4. What episode did you get to, or did you binge it all last night?
As soon as it came out the other day, I watched, like, the first 4 episodes very... Like, that's all I was doing was watching it, but I wanted to get through the whole season by the show. So I've had it playing in the background while doing other things, so not really fully. Don't worry, Joe, we're not going to spoil it.
That's not the best way to watch a show like Stranger Things. I mean, yeah. Most of the stuff is visual.
Yeah, I definitely, I took the wrong approach. So I'm going to go back and watch all the episodes that I kind of watched, and I'm going to watch them more intently. But yeah, from what I've, you know, so far, yeah, it's... yeah, just as good as the other seasons, and a lot of, without giving any spoilers, definitely a lot of you know, people playing, you know, the same characters, but playing different roles and taking on different responsibilities that would seem out of character for them the first two seasons. They changed up quite a bit, but it was still...
Steve is a father now. The internet is alive with memes of Steve being, like, everyone's dad now.
But, yeah, great, great, great show. And, yeah, I never realized the kid that plays, you know, the guy with the kid with the missing teeth and all that.
Oh,
I totally didn't realize that he actually had, like, this gnarly, this really rare disease. And, because they joke about it throughout, they make some jokes about it. And then, but yeah, there's a lot of interviews with that guy out there. He's got some rare disease that they actually, you know, kind of promote through the show. It's called CCD or something like that.
Well, I would say promote as much as acceptance.
Yeah, well, yeah,
he's,
I mean,
just
they,
born a little different.
Yeah, like, you know, they're promoting the awareness of it, but and he does like a lot of benefits and stuff for this organization called CCD Smiles. And,
nice.
But yeah, apparently it's, you know, his. First of all, his baby teeth never fell out, so they had to pull them out, and then his adult teeth that are supposed to be coming in, they won't come out either, so they have to put this device in there where they actually, they're basically dragging them out of his gums manually, and it also makes it to where his collarbones never grew. And so if you take a closer look at him in the show, you'll notice his collarbone, like he's got this weird shape from his neck to his shoulders. Like, it, you know, it just looks weird, and it's because he has this CCD problem.
Yeah, I think a neighbor of mine, like, way back when I was growing up, her daughter had this particular affliction, I guess, disability, and, yeah, like, she was probably about 8 years old, and still she had maybe three teeth. So it's a very, very, very unique... It's like, other than that, everything's fine, you know? It's a very unique disease to be born with.
Yeah, and honestly, I think with that kid that plays, man, what the hell is his name in the show? Dustin, right? Isn't that his name in the show? Something like that, but I think it suits his character perfectly, you know? The whole lisp and everything, I think it's perfect. So
yeah.
Yeah.
And like how he's like all actually. Like, it has embraced the mullet.
Yeah. That's the other thing I love about the show. I love the whole, you know, it's got that like Grand Theft Auto Vice City, you know, the soundtrack and the just the whole
80s
vibe.
Synth.
Yeah, it's got that 80s synth vibe. I really like the way they I mean, although don't get me wrong, I'm very glad that I missed the 80s, you know, cuz I don't know. Just, you know, all those hair metal bands and all that shift that was going on back then. Like,
what? Are you bagging on hair metal?
Dude, I mean, it's more than that, but I can just imagine being like a, you know, in like Poison or something, or a band like that. And then the 90s and 2000s come around and you have to look back on yourself like, man, I can't believe I did that. So I'm kind of glad I missed that.
I think it's rad.
I don't know. I think it's lame as shift. But you know what? I'm sure it was obviously the coolest thing going on at the time. So,
yeah, a few friends of ours have embraced that look. Just saying.
Yeah, that's true. But now it's and I know exactly which friends you're talking about. But it's a little bit cooler with him and them because nobody else is doing that now. But he's just like, the hell with it, dude. I'm doing it. I don't give a hell what you guys say. And it looks sick when he does it. Yeah. It looks sick when he does it, for sure.
Check out Infinite Empire.
Yeah, Infinite Empire, the band.
Infinite Empire.
Yeah, I'm not sure if the website might be under maintenance right now. But yeah, Infinite Empire, the band. Cool dudes. So yeah, anyway. You know, so I was watching, I watched this really long, hour-long sort of, it was supposed to be a debate, but it was really just, it was just Neil deGrasse Tyson and Richard Dawkins. Yeah, what? I know, but I
discussion?
Did, yeah, it was a little public discussion, and they brought up something that always kind of bothers me, especially when they use this as the final answer to the question, you know, and mm-hmm. So somebody asked in the audience, you know, the age-old question of where did life originate from? You know, then they talk about transpermia, right?
Yeah, oh, well, panspermia, not transpermia.
Transpermia
is probably a different thing.
Yeah, that might be another fun family activity for some people. But panspermia, you know, yeah. So, you know, which is the idea that, you know, something hit, most people, you know, attribute it to, you know, as far as life on Earth, you know, it came from, you know, some object hitting Mars, and then a piece of Mars flew off and landed on Earth, and so, like, oh, we figured it out. Life on Earth came from Mars.
Where did that asteroid come from?
Yeah, well, you know? Yeah, it's just like, where did the
go
life...
Go back and back and back. Yeah.
It just keeps going. You know, it's like if you went to a restaurant, you know, and you ask the chef, hey, do you know where this meat came from? Do you know where this beef came from? And he's like, yeah, I do. Like, okay, well, where did it come from? Oh, it came from the refrigerator in the back.
Yeah, exactly.
Right. Okay, but where did it come from before the refrigerator? Oh, well, it was in a box in the walk-in freezer before that. Like, okay, but where did it come from before that? Well, there was an 18-wheeler that pulled up. Yes, hey, dip shift. Where did the meat come from?
When it was alive.
And it's like, oh, you don't know? Okay, well, why don't you just say that?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. There's a certain amount of arrogance that that it surrounds, you know, Neil deGrasse Tyson and Richard Dawkins that I have noticed. This is just my opinion, because, you know, they do make a lot of valid points, but when it comes to where did life come from, and, you know, is there a more esoteric type subject matter, they're just like, it's in the refrigerator in a box. You know?
Yeah. But I was pretty proud of Neil deGrasse Tyson in that because in that setting, you know, because Richard Dawkins is the ultimate, you know, shut down any sort of interesting theory about life in space or anything like that.
Still owes Graham Hancock a DMT trip, a medically supervised DMT trip, or was it a psychedelic trip?
Well, yeah, he sort of copped out on that because I guess he had like some kind of stroke or something. So now he's saying like, oh, well, I'm not healthy enough to do it. Like, but yeah, I was proud of Neil though, because he actually, you know, because as much as Richard Dawkins doesn't like to admit, you know, they're being, you know, potentially being intelligent life in the universe, Neil deGrasse, you know, he almost represented us on that one. That's the most I've ever heard him talk like there has to be life out there if you think of the odds, and he starts throwing out all of his Neil deGrasse Tyson numbers and all that. But
it would just make sense versus, I guess, where like we're the only life at all, just ever. And one, it's pretty bleak. Two, it's like, well, that'd be an awful waste of space, literally.
Yeah, for sure. Now, so here's what we're gonna do. Since we're already a little bit into the show, I don't want to just throw out all the sponsors right away and take up a chunk of time. So we'll just do one. We'll slip them in throughout the episode. So we'll get one in right now. First sponsor of the show, of course, is Pure Health Defenders, the makers of C7 Tech and Sea Miracle. Sea Miracle being a sea vegetable-based superfood supplement. It's just absolutely fantastic for you. And then also C7 Tech, which comes in the form of a wristband and all kinds of other things, earrings, watches, little things for your pet's collar, you name it, but essentially uses a little chip the implant into these wristbands that uses scalar energy and atomic technology to realign the blood flow and the energy flow throughout your body. There's so much scientific evidence behind this and documentation. If you go to the website, purehealthdefenders.com, down in the middle of the homepage, you can download all the files and look at some of the thermal imaging that's been done of the before and after, from not having it on to 10 minutes after having it on to 20 minutes after having it on. And the effects are absolutely instantaneous and very dramatically awesome. So go check that out. And if you want any of those products, make sure to use the promo code SHIFTHAPPENS, and you will save yourself 50% off of your order, lifetime money back guarantee, no bullshit policy. Bam. All right.
I'm thinking about putting those one of those chips in a ring or you know, an earring or something, because I mean, I work at a jewelry shop, so or like a jewelry workshop, and they're teaching me stuff, you know. And so I'm like, where else can I put one of these little tiny chips that does all that awesomeness.
Yeah, there's possibilities are endless. And Brad's wife, Michelle, she's been making jewelry out of it. She's made rings and wrist, like, that's literally just a bunch of C7 Tech chips, like, all stringed together to make, like, a little bracelet and stuff like mm-hmm. that. And so, yeah, there you go. And all right, so, and like I said, we'll sneak in the other sponsors throughout the show. But for now, without any further ado whatsoever, tonight's guest, the Grailianist extraordinaire, the originator of the bunker, and three-time world champion of the world's greatest vocabulist, Micah Hanks. What's happening, Micah?
Well, I don't know about that, but I'll try to live up to the, what do we call that now, a meme? I guess that's probably going to be a...
Are you a meme? Vocabulist, so just insert it into the fabric.
That's right. Vocabulist in residence here on Shift Happens. Well, in any case, glad to be here with you, children. Glad to be here as always.
Children.
Well, you got to keep in mind, if you're 4,000 years old, or at very least you feel like it, you're old and grizzled enough to almost look like it. Yeah, you know, everybody around me are children. The beloved little children, the flock, right? And that makes me, I guess, the one who tends the flock, which everybody better run or watch out. God help if any wolves show up, right?
Hey, I'm 292 over here, and I rule the whole known universe. Everybody's my flock, even you.
Yeah, but that's Earth years. That's Earth years, Cortana. Man, you're always thinking Gregorian on this. When are we ever going to shift into another
Do we need to think Alexandrian? Oh, wait, no, I'm thinking Wiccan.
You're going back even further. But anyway, that's neither here nor there. We'll keep numerology off the table for tonight, because apparently vocabulary is the new it thing, the new meme, the lady. You know, speaking of Richard Dawkins, by the way, you know, he coined that term meme. And certainly when he wrote about that, he didn't mean the kind of thing that we mean, because we typically mean cats rolling around acting cute on Saturdays when we say meme.
Yeah. And a meme is like what a thought that penetrates through the whole of society, where it's just like, it just kind of attaches to the general consciousness.
Right. That's more what it means today. Although I think that Dawkins actually even meant it in a different way, because keeping in mind, you know, the way that he was trying to articulate these thoughts with regard to, and actually a lot of people would say that if you go back to his book, The Selfish Gene, and, you know, you read that, some people are like, well, you know, again, this was his first primary offering on the subject in terms of popular writing, and you can't fault him for the flaws. But other people are like, actually, you know, this is a profound book, and it still needs to be read by everybody today. Now, in that same line of thought, and I absolutely advocate everybody go read that book, but Julian James has nothing to do with Richard Dawkins. Well, I mean, you might say that there are definitely some connections, but again, this is I think he was a Harvard psychology professor at the time that he wrote the book, The Origin of Consciousness and the Breakdown of the Bicameral Mind. I bring him up because here's another guy who wrote this book. It was the only book that he wrote. I mean, Dawkins has gone on to write all kinds of stuff and has really stayed in the public zeitgeist, as evidenced by that conversation you guys were referencing with Neil deGrasse Tyson. Julian James, he puts forth this idea, and he writes this remarkable book, and everybody kind of goes, well, yeah, that was just roundly debunked. Some who actually read that book, which the general premise is that consciousness, he perceives, as we know it today, consciousness seems to be a fairly recent arrival, and that he says you can go back to books from antiquity, you know, writings, the Iliad, right? You can read Homer, you can read, you know, any number of different writings, you know, going all the way back to Gilgamesh. And he says that the same sort of characterization of consciousness in terms of awareness of I, et cetera, is not present in those early writings. And he thinks that actually the mind functioned in a different way in that era. And specifically, the way that he articulated the function of the mind was that it would communicate to us. So maybe to kind of give a gross simplification here, I'm walking down the street and I see, you know, a fire ahead. And my mind says to me, quite literally says to me, Micah, watch out, there's a fire ahead. Don't go down there. And I'm like, ah, you're right. Gosh, I shouldn't. Which puts a lot of these traditional mystical experiences where people describe what, to borrow from what Paul Brunton wrote about in the 1940s, the spiritual teacher and the meditation practitioner, he referred to the overself, this part of this aspect of oneself that when you enter a deep meditation, and you've practiced meditation enough over time that you can get into this sort of a, again, an altered, it's very much an altered state. He said that, you know, you begin to have these experiences where you feel as though you are being spoken to by an aspect of your own consciousness. And he called that the overself. So anyway, not to immediately derail the conversation.
Well, I mean, that actually plays with something that I've been thinking about these last few days, because, one, you point that out about, like, I'm still discovering new and awesome things about my mind. And so I'm like, Wait, there's no I up there? I thought Everybody thought like this, and you know, the types of thinking and the way people process information, and even how that's evolved culturally. Because I mean, I have read that most books written, you know, thousands of years ago read out loud to an audience. Reading was, you know, akin to listening to a podcast back a few thousand years ago.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of fascinating. And again, the primary reason I bring that up is because sometimes revolutionary new, you know, how do I want to put this? Statements on thought, or simply ideas, sometimes come out in those early books, those early writings. For Julian James, that was the only thing that he ever really wrote. It was his magnum opus. I think that there's still wisdom to be found there. Absolutely the same thing with Richard Dawkins and the Selfish Gene. But the presentation of that idea of the meme may not have been, you know, at that time what we recognize it as fully today. But again, we absolutely borrow that from lingo he introduced into the zeitgeist. And now it's really a thing. It's just kind of a shame that there's a broader meaning behind it. Most people, again, think of cats, you know, and funny pictures and stuff.
To kind of still like ride this whole meme boat with you, it's more like, okay, so have you heard of meme magic? You know, how that one group was doing that Keck magic, and it started, they were channeling some entity called Keck in their memes and stuff, and things were suddenly manifesting. And I've read a lot about it. I'm still trying to comprehend meme magic, but I was wondering if you actually knew about that, or had gazed upon that sort of phenomenon in your studies.
I haven't, Cortana. I haven't gazed upon that one. But I will say, though, that sounds remarkably similar to the idea of the Philip experiment, which everybody's familiar with. And if you're not, here it comes. I mean, you know, the idea that,
if
people claim to experience paranormal phenomena in an environment that we would deem a quote unquote haunted house, let's just see if we can create our own haunting and essentially assign that to any place. And so with the Philip experiment, they did just that. They said, you know, here's this character, we're going to create a history for him and everything. And then before long, it starts taking on its own kind of personality. And people, rather than fabricating the experiences, begin to claim to have experiences that they feel could not have been of the authoring of the team itself. Let's put it that way. Now, many people interpret that as being, see, this is what we call an exercise in manifestation, where you say, okay,
yes,
well, we will create a ghost and we will put so much thought and energy behind it that we manifest it and the thing comes to life. There was the old term in the Tibetan, the tulku, for that,
yeah,
which has been, it's been appropriated, I think, in English since the 1950s as tulpa, but that is essentially the same concept, a sort of a thought form. Now,
made a few myself.
Right.
Before.
And what is interesting is, again, the other way we could look at that is more in the context of what we're talking about here. What if it were simply the powers of the mind? Again, just like what you're saying, where a meme seems to take on a mind of its own. Would you really call that a sentience? No, but you begin to see an element of the way that this operates in this aspect of the web sphere or society or whatever, which is completely autonomous, or seemingly so, from the creators of said meme, which the meme phenomena is interesting in that capacity. You create something that's funny, people innately sort of, quote unquote, get it, and then it begins to build on itself. Well, does it really? No, it's creative minds that almost in a subliminal way, you know, they aren't even fully conscious of the way that they're building onto or creating that narrative. As I mean, it's evolving in real time as it's being used. And this is fundamental to the nature of the meme. When these things erupt into our public consciousness, it is this kind of a user agreement where if you're going to play with this, it is understood that you adapt and you control it too, which is kind of fascinating. It's almost like a hive mind kind of thing. There seems to be very much a hive mind aspect to human behavior.
Memes. even if it's like the serious thing, I just still think of just some, you know, ancient meme of Shoop de Whoop or, you know, you mad bro, as we're explaining these high esoteric concepts.
Yeah, right. Or just go ahead and throw Cerebro in there as well. There's your Stranger Things episode 1, season 3
it's
reference.
Cerebro.
Yeah, I'm not going to say anything else either. Anyway. You know, we are in the no spoiler zone.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, okay, so real quick, Hobo. So we need to take our first break, and but we'll be right back in just a few short minutes. So ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Shift Happens here for The Fringe FM. I'm your host, Gigi, along with my co-host, Cortana, and we're here with Micah Hanks from The Graylian Report. All right, folks, we'll see you in just a few. Don't go anywhere.
Okay, here we go. AncientLifeOil.com. AncientLifeOil.com. Now, this is for CBD. AncientLifeOil.com. Again, for CBD. Where do I get CBD? AncientLifeOil.com. It's pretty good stuff. Organic, non-GMO. We are the Ferrari of CBDs. AncientLifeOil.com. You know, they say when you mention a person's name 3 times when you first meet, that you're going to remember. So I'd say to you, nice to meet you, AncientLifeOil.com. It's AncientLifeOil.com, right? Nice to know that you help people. AncientLifeOil.com. Think about this. Occasional stress, occasional anxiety, occasional inflammation, occasional stiffness, and intruders that get you down. AncientLifeOil.com. Okay, so I'm going to give you a fact for the day. So Ancient Life Oil does not help you with business deals. Hold on a second. If you feel better, it could help you make a better decision. Okay, I'm wrong. Just remember to go to AncientLifeOil.com.
From birth, we have been conditioned to conform to what is normal, conditioned to adhere to authority, and conditioned to repeat what has been told to us as truth. I'm Ryan Gable, and here at The Secret Teachings Radio, I've interviewed hundreds of great guests and done extensive unique research into subjects that span from the paranormal and the occult to health, philosophy, and history. I personally have no affiliations or agenda, except to use objective critical thinking in my analysis of every subject discussed, to empower myself with information, and hopefully allow you to do the same. If you want to join me, tune into The Secret Teachings radio broadcast, airing live Monday through Friday from midnight to 3 a.m. U.S. Pacific Standard Time on The Fringe FM. For more information, you can visit our website at www.thesecretteachings.info or email me at rdgable@yahoo.com.
Pure Health Defenders, proud sponsor of Shift Happens, producing organic and natural health, wellness, and technology products for people, pets, and plants to thrive alive. Pure Health Defenders, also known as PHD, is powered by C7 Technology, Scalar Energy Atomic Technology, and fueled by Sea Miracle Superfoods. 118 nutrients of the purest sea vegetables Mother Earth has to offer. Recognized 100% by people, pets, and plants, delivering the value the same. Everybody deserves a PhD. Be smart about it. Come join the healthiest family today.
kids, don't drink in park. Accidents cause people. This has been a PSA brought to you by your friends at Shift Happens and The Fringe FM.
Hey guys, do you struggle with low testosterone levels? Symptoms of low testosterone affect your optimum functioning as a man, and this includes loss of motivation, fatigue, and lack of libido. Well, now there's a way to increase your testosterone levels and combat these symptoms, and do it naturally. How? It's called Red Stag for Men, the all-new male enhancement formula designed to do just that. Red Stag is formulated with some of the most frequently studied natural ingredients that are known to raise higher testosterone levels. Higher testosterone levels have been known to increase your drive, as well as reduce body fat, improve lean muscle mass, and boost your energy. Red Stag is taken once daily, yet works all day naturally. So go to MyRedStag.com right now and get your 60-day supply. Red Stag. Remember, take the red pill. Proven ingredients. Proven performance. Go to MyRedStag.com right now. That's MyRedStag.com.
Hey, is that a new music app?
Yeah, check it out, Surfer Music Discovery. It links to thousands of online stations, but the twist is you see the song names and artists that are now playing live.
That's different. No guessing. Looks like a waterfall of music.
So many formats. Rock, oldies, country, R&B, jazz, and a whole lot more.
How's that spelled?
Surfer. S-U-R-F-R.
Is it expensive?
It's free. No need to sign up or sign in.
Get the Surfer Music app free from Google Play or the App Store.
KTLK Digital Broadcast. We rock the paranormal talk.
Hello. 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 Hello.
Fringe FM, this is Shift Happens. I'm your host, GG, along with my co-host, Cortana. And we're here with none other than Micah Hanks, Hobbs, from The Grillion Report. Now, real quick before we get back, hey, what's happening, Alan? What's happening, IPD? Dan, James, everybody in the chat room, Kat, Sandra, Dennis, Joe, Astro Sweet, Mr. White, all of you. Thank you for joining us tonight. Now real quick, sneak another sponsor in there. This show is brought to you by, also, by Flaxseed 60, the makers of Flaxseed 60 with, well, C60 with flax oil as the delivery method, which adds even more extra wonderful goodness to the already amazing benefits of C60. If you don't know what C60 is, look it up, Carbon 60, very good. There's a really good interview with Patty Greer and Mr. Ken Schwartz from C60 Purple Power. If you type Patty Greer, C60 Purple Power, it'll pop right up. And yeah, some of the best stuff you can put into your body. And if you go to wait, that's right. They still have no need for a promo code right now for a limited time. It's 10% off for everybody. So just go to flaxseed60.com and get your goodness. Get your goodness today from flaxseed60.com, Hobbs. All right. So, Micah, now it's been a while. It's been well over a year, I think, since we've had you on the show. And you're a man of many tasks, I might say. Many trades, many tasks. And you do a lot of, you're a bit of a, you're almost like an Indiana Jones in a sense. You do a lot of work with involving archaeology, and you actually go on digs yourself. And so what this whole last year, what's all been What have you been up to on that front of things?
Well, yeah, there's always a lot going on. And keep in mind, I mean, I'm not a professional archaeologist. So if I'm out there in the field and I'm participating in a dig, it's always with the assistance of professional archaeologists. In fact, actually, if anything, I'm the one who's assisting them because they're the professionals. And I mean, honestly, the problem with archaeology is, as with many other disciplines, there is a limited amount of funding, time, resources, you know, manpower. And so often it is a small, like if we're doing an archaeological dig in the Southeast, it will be someone like Dr. Christopher Moore, you know, good friend of ours, or somebody, and they will be overseeing a dig. And then we will have some DNR folks out there, you know, and you know, a very small number of paid archaeologists who are professionals who are really kind of, you know, doing the bulk of the work and overseeing everything that is being done by everyone else. Now, everyone else is going to be anyone from grad students who are earning their way up to being able to be in the, you know, the upper echelons of American archaeology in that sense, you know, earning their PhDs and the like. And so they're out there having to gain their field experience. Or we also may have situations where there are volunteers. The volunteers may range from people, you know, like my team and I, the Seven Ages Research Associates, people who have educated ourselves, although it's primarily self-education. You know, we have a pretty good working knowledge of the archaeological process in terms of not only, you know, book learning in the field of anthropology, but also, you know, field experience from having worked on digs. And then you've got a lot of people who are just interested in archaeology and who are there volunteering on the site. And they may be anyone from people our age who are what you might call avocationalists. In archaeology, this is a term that means people who are dedicated amateurs. They don't have a PhD or even a master's degree, maybe not a bachelor's degree, but they nonetheless are involved in field work. They are hobbyists. They're interested. They may be involved in field collecting. And, you know, especially in some of the southern states, you've got to be careful because when it comes to going out there and collecting artifacts and things, there are regulations in certain states where, you know, I think almost everywhere, collecting outside of areas where you are explicitly legally able to do is completely frowned upon. In fact, there's a whole different word for that. It's called looting, you know, and you never go and you don't ever dig on property, federal land or anything where you don't have permission to do this. So for all of those reasons, you know, I like to point out right at the outset, you know, I don't just go out there like Indiana Jones and enter a cave and go dig up treasures from the past completely without, you know, the proper kind of setting, the proper kind of licensing and certification, and most importantly, the kinds of professionals on the site who can oversee an operation like that, which is something that I'm not qualified to do, but they're always helpful in terms of educating people in the public who are interested in doing this kind of thing. And they're very glad to have people who truly are passionate and who have taught themselves and who are interested in the archaeological process. And so as a result of the team and I being involved in a lot of digs and things like this, we've made a lot of great friends because, you know, I think they're used to people who are there because it's like, oh, cool, Saturday there's an archaeology dig and they need some people to help. Cool, we'll go dig some dirt, versus the people who are there going, so guys, 12,900 years ago, there was this event, the Younger Dryas, and we're all trying to figure out what happened. Now, based on dendrochronological data, tree ring data, we can learn only so much because, again, you know, there's data that can be gleaned from that, but then again, there are other areas we may find other information. Let's look at, you know, paleoglaciological data. Let's look at, you know, sediment cores from the actual site that we're looking at. Let's look at this so-called black mat layer. Let's look at the geochemical data. When you show up on the site and you have a knowledge of all these kind of things and you're talking with the PhDs, they tend to get really excited. In fact, there's a term they have for that. They call it nerd talk, and I'm sure you guys at home can all see why. But that's really, at the end of the day, what we're trying to do is understand, you know, scientifically what was happening in the ancient past, what role humans played in what was happening. For instance, with regard to megafauna and their eventual extinction, did humans hunt them to extinction, or were there other factors that played into that? What was happening to human populations around the time of 12,900 years ago during this so-called Younger Dryas, where there was this massive climate change event, and we're still trying to understand exactly what it was that instigated that? So these are all questions we have in mind. You know, my people that I work with, we try to go about this as scientifically as possible. No, you don't have to have a PhD to think scientifically. But having a proper education certainly helps. I would mainly contend, however, that if you are dedicated and if you know where to look, there are a lot of different ways that you can gain that knowledge, that you can gain that education. I, for one, am an autodidact. I'm self-taught. Maybe that doesn't work for everybody. But again, I think what it has helped with is it has helped me not become entirely too entrenched in certain ideas and systems of belief as it relates to concepts in modern American archaeology. And in fact, many of my friends who are the PhDs, the professors, and the like, they feel the same way. They feel that there is a certain degree of entrenchment and that there is this kind of gatekeeping phenomena where, oh, wow, once an idea becomes the consensus opinion, if any data is forthcoming that seems to challenge that, there is a natural resistance to that idea. Yeah. And so we're seeing that, and we have been seeing that for the last few decades now in archaeology. But guys, we could step over into the realm of UFOs and talk about that. Almost any subject where there is something that appears to have enough tangible data worthy of scientific discussion or study, you're going to find these sort of entrenched attitudes, and you're going to find this resistance to new data. That seems to be tantamount to not only the human experience, but definitely toward the scientific experience. And what's kind of funny, and I'll say this, and then I promise I'm going to turn it back over to you guys, but, you know, again, it's important to get these things out on the table. Talking with a former epidemiologist the other day, he shared with me some very fascinating perspectives on the idea that, you know, again, if extraterrestrial life existed, why would government hide that? And what he fundamentally said was, hey, look, you know, here's the thing. We can't lead with expectations. We can't try to build our argument around, well, this is why I think this is likely and therefore I believe it. Science always proceeds in the cautious manner of, well, you know, we go with what we know and we always introduce a check for falsehood. And if at the end of the day we cannot prove it rock solid, we say it doesn't exist. So I'll just say there are a lot of things that don't exist for which there may be a lot of instrumental data or a lot of data that's acquired in other ways. Nonetheless, data that seems to suggest something which science still would recognize as non-existent for those reasons. It's kind of complex. I get it. And so those are all the kind of things we deal with, and that's what I've been doing for the last year, G.
Nice. And, yeah, and, you know, at one point when I was younger, I really that's something I thought I wanted to do was become an archaeologist. And But the more I looked into it and some books I lightly treaded through, it kind of, you know, because in my mind it was like, oh, I'm going to discover a new species of this or I'm going to do this. But really, 98% of the time, you're like, it's very rare to find something. You know, there's probably only a few times in someone's career throughout decades of doing it where they, if they're lucky enough to even find something, you know, have that adventurous moment where they uncover the next biggest thing. Whereas most of the time you're, you know, it's not as, you know, it's real tedious work. Kind of like IPD said earlier, he says it's tedious digging with a paintbrush. And but you have to do it that way so that you don't, you know, you got to be careful so that you don't ruin whatever you end up coming up with. But
I love that, by the way. I love what IPD said. Yeah, about tedious digging with a paintbrush. That, folks, is no joke when you're actually out there on the dig site. Depending on what you're doing, you know, sometimes the TA soil, you know, the upper levels of soil, especially if you're going to be doing a dig that has to do with archaic or a Paleo-Indian focus, you know, which we're talking about, you know, anywhere from, gosh, I mean, if we're going to talk about, you know, early archaic, well, actually, let's start with late archaic. We're going backward maybe 3,000 years ago to as much as 12,000 years ago. That takes us back around to the area of Clovis, which actually extends even further back. But, I mean, in that general area, if you're going to be digging in that kind of a realm, I mean, again, you're not looking for Mississippi and late woodland, middle woodland, early woodland stuff. And that comprises several thousands of years. And so certain digs, you know, they'll remove that entire upper layer because, hey, yeah, we know we're going to find some arrowheads and some things and some pottery shards, you know, from the Mississippian period, for instance. But that's not the focus of this study. What we want to try and learn is about, you know, the archaic or the Paleo-Indian occupation in this area during that time frame. So they'll go down below that entire soil level and start the dig at the lower level. But once you get down into the area where it's like, okay, now we're in our prime area and this is the zone. This is where stuff's going to start happening. Yeah, there are stories. In fact, Meadowcroft Rock Shelter up in Pennsylvania, J.M. Atavasio, he led the excavations there beginning in 1973. And they found what, again, is widely believed and agreed upon as being irrefutable evidence of pre-Clovis occupation. And more specifically, they found a very enigmatic little lancelet point that they call the Miller Lancelet. And this little arrowhead, this projectile point, again, it's unlike anything that you see going all the way back to the Clovis period, which was once believed to be the earliest arrivals in America. They found that at Meadowcroft Rock Shelter. And in the deepest strata where there were evidences of human occupation, I mean, I think on the nearer end, the most conservative estimates, they were dating that to about 16,000 years ago. However, there are also radiocarbon dates there that go back maybe in advance of 20,000 or even 30,000 years. But as I asked Dr. Atavasio about that, I said, you know, you guys have radiocarbon dates, so why don't you go with that? And he said, well, you know, again, because if you take into consideration the plus or minus on those dates, you know, we go with the nearer end, which brings us back to about 16,000. That's a safe bet. But that still is well in advance of anything that we know. Well, at least at the time that they were digging at Meadowcroft and they started digs there, anything that we knew to exist in America. But when they were doing that kind of work and they were uncovering those kinds of finds, Atavasio was well known for having his grad students out there with literally a razor blade. And they would be sifting sand with a razor blade so fine that you could, I mean, literally, yeah. A sneeze would disrupt the areas that they were working on. And I've spoken with some of his former students who talked about that and said, yeah, he absolutely did have us out there with razor blades, sifting the sediment with razor blades. So it is a very, very fine process, and paintbrushes aren't even the most fine, refined tools that are used in some of those digs, as evidenced by Atavasio up there at Meadowcroft. So, yeah, it's absolutely a tedious process. It's sometimes backbreaking work when you're shoveling the dirt out of the areas where you know you're not going to find anything, sterile soil areas, and you're just having to shovel. I've come away from those dig sites in great pain and unable to really rest comfortably for a few days. But, hey, this is how you learn about the past. It's not easy. Nobody ever said it was.
Excavate an archaeological dig because although razor blades are very, very good at it.
Cortana, we can barely hear you. Did you, is there something you can do over there?
Hi.
Yeah, you were sounding good earlier. We can barely hear you now.
Strange. Keep going. We don't want.
All right, yeah. Well, while you work on that, so Micah Hobbs. As an archaeologist, archaeology hobbyist, I guess you could say, So I'm going to go into space for a few minutes here, but then after the break, I want to take it back to, you know, like we're talking about on the show, you know, there's all this, you know, focus and effort into exploring life, not only in our solar system, but also potentially in other solar systems as well. But at the same time, we don't even know, we've only explored like 8% of what's under the water, much less, we still don't know what the hell's going on in the Congo. I mean, in a sense, I feel like we should probably figure out, what's going on here first, right? Before we start thinking about off-planet stuff. But at the same time, I'm curious, as an archaeology hobbyist, I might call it. If you had like one trip, all expenses paid, and you got to pick your team, whatever, and you were able to go anywhere in the solar system to do an archaeological dig, where would you go, and why, and why, Hobbs?
Well, it's funny because. As far as doing archaeology, to try and go out there into our solar system and conduct archaeological research, it would be a remarkably difficult thing to try and say that you wanted to go and do, and here's why. without any realistic expectation that there is life on any of the major planets in our solar system. I say major planets because, again, Pluto was, again, it was demoted. They may bring it back, but then they're also saying that there is perhaps further out there a large object of some kind beyond the Kuiper belt that we haven't identified yet. It would be difficult to be able to say that there's a good rationale for archaeological excavation on a site like that, because here's the thing. You know, archaeology has to do with human populations, and we're talking about working in the context of humans, or at very least we could extend that to astrobiology, and we could say, you know, human-like life forms, intelligent life forms on another planet. Intelligent may also be something that's completely unlike us. Intelligent could be something that would behave a lot more like maybe Australopithecus or, you know, one of our ancient ancestors. But let's say their intelligence isn't, you know, Wi-Fi, modems, you know, smartphones, aircraft, things like that. Let's say that their intelligence is, again, compared with, you know, lithic, you know, types from, you know, Paleo-Indian era North America, or even going back further, if we want to go to Europe, you know, let's say that there are actually go all the way back to Africa. You know, very, very simple stone tools that perform a very basic function. They are, some of them may actually be pre-bifacial, you know, where they're only shaped on one side in a way that they perform simple functions, hand axes, things like this, scrapers. Nonetheless, there's intelligence involved in this tool making and rudiments of culture. And that definition shifts over time as well. Shift does happen, see? Yeah, but the thing is, well, I would just say this, though. If I were looking for archaeological evidence of something elsewhere in our solar system, you know, you're not going to find all those things on another planet, conceivably. So the first place I would actually look, if I had to pick someplace off of planet Earth, would be on our moon. And not because I have a realistic expectation that there was ever life on the moon, but nonetheless, it's close enough that we have already observed some tantalizingly strange, I don't want to call them objects or artifacts, but there have been some formations found on the lunar surface that are very interesting. And although they're probably, you couldn't call it geological. Would it be lunarological? But nonetheless,
new word.
Yeah, we'll create new words on it if we have to. But the point is yeah, there's a strong case to be made that there are some interesting things to be found on the moon. That's the first place I would start looking, and I would move out from there. But my big point, G, and I'm sure you knew I was going to go in this direction. For me, the idea of trying to do archaeological research out there in space is a nice concept for now. But both on the archaeological scope of things and also in the paleontological, and frankly, let's just say that in terms of extant animal species today and the zoological scope of things, there's a whole lot, I suspect, that has yet to be found on planet Earth. And before we go out there looking for anything, we need to really have a full mastery of the biota that may exist on this planet before we're looking for something else out there. That's what my contention would be.
And for example, you know, like I think you just talked about this on one of your more recent shows, was, you know, for hundreds of years, if not longer than that, you know, the idea of now there's a term for these things. I'm sure you'll correct me in a second here, but basically what we would call giant squid that starts with an A. What's the name for it again?
Archituthis?
Archituthis. Yeah, right. So for the longest time in history, this was thought to be a mythological creature, right? Until just in the last like 3 or 4 years, you know, we're starting to get real. Now, I know they found some corpses, but you know, there was still no proof that they actually still existed until the one guy or gal rather in Japan and her team out there, they got a brief little video clip of one. And then just recently, there was one off of the Gulf of Mexico in pretty much U.S. waters. And, you know, that's something that, you know, which was thought to be mythology forever. And just very recently, you know, we're starting to prove these things to be true. So, there's a lot of great stuff left to be found here. But now, one point, one thing you reminded me of, going back to another thing I heard Neil deGrasse Tyson say on, I think it was the remember it used to be Opie and Anthony, now it's Sam and Jim Norton or whatever. But they had Neil deGrasse Tyson on there, and I didn't even know this, but he was talking about Pluto. You know, we just mentioned, you know, everybody knows it's been degraded, you know, downgraded as a planet. But
his grudge against Pluto.
But
what's up with that?
He was the first one to admit that they very recently, just this last year or two, have discovered that there's actual, once again, I guess you couldn't call it geographic, but there is, you know, there's
topographic?
There's tectonic plate movements. Tectonic? There's actual what we would call geographical, you know, it's an active forming, changing body. It's not just a piece of rock flying around out there.
So he makes the case that it functions enough like a planet that it should still be treated as such, right?
Yeah, pretty much. He didn't go as far to say as it should be reinstated as a planet, but he very clearly stated, like, yeah, we had the wrong idea. It actually is very planet-like.
Well, again, you know, here's the whole thing. You know, people have argued for years that if the object is large enough that it clears its own path in the sense that, you know, it has enough of a gravitational pull that as it is moving in its elliptical orbit around the sun, this object actually removes debris from its path, as Earth does, and sometimes collects fairly large satellites like our moon, although there's also the conjecture that the moon may have been at one time a portion of the Earth. For all we know, it actually may be the fragmentary remains of one hell of an impact that occurred a long time ago. Talk about shift. But, I mean, at the end of the day, really, I guess all you could say is Hobbes. And that this object, you know, out there, further out in the solar system, I mean, this thing, we can't even fully detect it, and yet they say it may be large enough, you know, to dwarf some of the smaller planets. Maybe at the end of the day, what we're really trying to say is we need to rethink the way that we define what a planet is. But we're always going to have an anthropo or a geocentric, I guess, and if we're talking about Earth, a geocentric perspective on things. Well, we're alive. And we know that for it to be habitable, it must be a planet, right? So we're on one. So what's like us? What's like this? Well, look out in our universe, you know? Hell, don't go that far. Just look in our neighborhood, our solar system. There aren't other planets like Earth that have an abundance of water, you know, that have a breathable, livable atmosphere, that have a large enough satellite that is capable of governing the kinds of, again, the lunar cycles with regard to circadian activities, you know, tidal activities. Then again, all these things, it helps when you got water on hand, I guess, in terms of being able to gauge those things. But most other planets, even a large one, a massive gas giant like Jupiter, you know, if you look at it, even with a good pair of binoculars on a clear night, you're going to see a little ring. I call it the pearl necklace of Jupiter. It's got like a little ring of...
Oh, dear.
Yes, uh-oh. Get your mind out of the gutter, Cortana! But a little. There's going to be a little ring of moons, a little, you know, again, a little string of moons that you can see around. Those things are dwarfed by the larger planetary body itself. Earth, on the other hand, yeah, moons. Our moon's not quite as big as our planet is, but it's big in relation to our planet. And some would further, you know, again, Randall Carlson and I have talked about this a lot, the idea that what if the requisite for life on a planet, among other things, is actually having a large enough satellite that it actually can kind of counterbalance and govern some of those functions that are occurring on the larger planet planetary body. I mean, these are all questions we still have, and we're still trying to understand these kind of things. The reason why is because we don't have a single reliably, we don't have another reliable circumstance where the conditions have been found on another planetary body elsewhere in our solar system or anywhere else where we know life exists and where we can observe what life would function like and how it would behave on a planet similar to or very different from our own. Again, as far as we know, this universe is barren and we're all that there is. Now, I doubt that. I know out there in my heart, there must be life. There must be something like life. It may not be like we see life here on Earth, you know, but I think that there's life out there. But it's an interesting question at the end of the day where you have to kind of start saying, okay, we really, if we're going to understand how all this goes, have got to start thinking outside the box. And there may be little innocuous traits with relation to our own planet and those nearest to us, that if we start observing these things, it's going to help us understand where it will be and what it's going to manifest like elsewhere when and if we find it.
Yeah, and actually, that's exactly, believe it or not, what Richard Dawkins was saying. Pretty impressed that he was acknowledging it like that. I was like, okay, he's kind of on board here.
He's totally on board. And, yeah, Dawkins is brilliant. He turns a lot of people off because, and rightly so, I think he becomes very skeptical, and he even becomes confrontational of people who challenge science. But you know, if you actually watch the video of Graham Hancock standing up and asking him the question at the town hall there when they were, you know, together and he came to Graham's town, if you guys saw that, Dawkins was a sweetheart to Graham Hancock.
Yeah.
Dawkins is not a person who is overtly confrontational just to be that way. Yes, he takes serious issue with the idea of deities and monotheistic religion and things like this, but
as we all probably actually, should.
But if you see his the way when he gets hot under the collar, it's when he's doing a panel discussion with people generally, and someone starts challenging him on something, or they're laughing at the idea of evolution, and he becomes exasperated because as a scientist who has he's devoted his whole life to this, and it's like, my God, what does it take to get you people to understand? This is not just me rattling off. This is a thing. This is accepted. This is consensus knowledge. Yeah, he gets frustrated, you know.
But yeah, I think I definitely got a new because I'll be honest. Before Hobbes, recently, I've only taken other people's. Never really looked into his stuff personally. I've just always heard stories of their confrontations with him and all these different, third-hand accounts of his closed-mindedness. But after that talk with Neil deGrasse Tyson, I was like, oh, he's a lot more open-minded than I thought. And, I have a lot more respect for that guy now. But now another thing I'm going to skip the middle break. That should have already happened. But before anybody at the network worries, don't worry. I've reallocated all of the network commercials are in the first break that we already did and the one that we're going to do later. So all the network breaks are going to be there. Nobody worry. Everything's okay. The ship has not rocked. All right. So here's another, even though I was just bashing panspermia at the beginning of the show, if we were to trace life just one step back before Earth, and this kind of comes between a point that Neil made and actually Hawkins agreed with and elaborated on as well, and also with a point that Mike Barra made that kind of gives us some credibility, I think, is, there's multiple examples of this. The most recent one, I think it was like 96, they found this meteor out in Antarctica, and which was very positively identified as coming from Mars. And there were there was various types of organic life that was from Mars, one of which was basically what they described as a little worm that was about one-tenth of the size of the smallest worm ever found on Earth, which is like really like pretty much microscopic, a very tiny little thing, but it was a thing. And so there is, and then, you know, and as Neil said, at least deGrasse Tyson, he says, according to him, they very strongly believe that there used to be water on Mars. But then, you talk to people like Billy Carson, he'll tell you that there's still water on there today and all the research they're doing with UFO and all that. But that's neither here nor there. It's pretty widely accepted that Mars used to have water, and at the very least there could have been, microorganisms and the foundations of life and some forms of life there, perhaps not intelligent, but nonetheless. So you have these meteors coming from Mars hitting Earth. Perhaps that's where it came from. But then one thing that kind of made me really think that this might be the case is, Mike Barra was saying one time that when you take humans into space, out of the Earth orbit, actually in space, and after just a period of a couple of days, their circadian rhythm switches to a 24.9-hour cycle rather than a 24-hour cycle, which...
Yeah, isn't that Mars time?
Yes. If we were from Mars, if we were on Mars, that would be our circadian rhythm, would be 24.9 hours. So it's like, maybe our origins did come from there. But, just wanted to throw that out there for you guys to chew on that a little bit. But,
That's very interesting, by the way.
Yeah, it really, when you kind of put all that together, it's like, there might be something to this. But that's kind of, we don't know much more than that. It's just there needs to be more research done on that, I guess. But enough about space.
So that might be a good, that might be actually a good thing to, you know, instead of handling all the stuff on Earth before we go out there, well, sometimes we have to go out there in order to make more discoveries down here.
Yeah, it's certainly, it's we might be shedding some light on where, you know, because, I mean, the timeline makes sense. Someone shut Gigi up. All right. Speaking of which.
No. I love hearing this guy talk. You got to keep in mind.
Yeah.
Where this all began was in a hotel room in Big Bear Lake, California. Gigi and I, well, we weren't alone. There happened to have been a bottle of bourbon in the room as well. And, you know, I could tell that conversation was going to be, well, you know, what my good friend and mentor in radio many years ago, John Anderson, used to say. He says, a real relationship that lasts is a good conversation that never ends. We're still having this conversation. So I'll never ask you to shut up, sir. I enjoy your ramblings.
Well,
you indulge mine graciously.
So indulgent.
Well, and not to mention the epic conversations we had on the drive to Hollywood as well.
Then, and also breakfast at Mel's Diner.
Yeah.
God.
That was
best
fantastic.
Orange juice in the world, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah, I mean, that really was, I can taste it right now. That was some unusually fresh orange juice, especially for being in Hollywood. But anyway,
orange groves are right over around the corner. Like, you just, you know.
They picked them that morning.
Yeah.
The requirement of living in California is everybody who can't have a tree has an orange tree in their front and or backyard. It is a time-honored tradition of the California people.
Yeah, in fact, the last place I lived in North Hollywood, there was an orange tree in my backyard. And let me tell you, folks, all the pollution aside, it could have tasted better, I'm sure. But man, there's nothing like a fresh picked orange right outside your door. Now, ironically, the person who said for me to shut up, I'm actually on B-Sides this Sunday. He's going to be our guest. And that's JP from Inflammatory Talk. And so we'll be doing a B-side show this Sunday night at 7. You won't want to miss this one, folks. We always have a good talk, though he'll probably tell me to shut up a few times. So, but anyway, so Hobbs. So one thing we've never really, even when we've had people, you know, like I was telling you earlier, we've had a couple of folks on the show, whether it was, Ronnie LeBlanc or Steve Marilla or Alex Mistretta. We've had some of these guys on that could have easily talked about Bigfoot. We just never got to that. And that's something I don't think we've really ever talked about in depth. And this is something that you're very knowledgeable on, but not only knowledgeable, you take a very, you know, because most Bigfoot researchers are just kind of very biased and they kind of tend to jump to conclusions, whereas that's one of the best Micah Hanks traits about Micah Hanks is that, you know, he's very realistic about the facts and about the I don't know why I'm talking about you in third person. You're very realistic about the evidence, and you've been researching this a lot. So let's get into some Bigfoot stuff now. See, here's my thing, and I think part of the reason why we've never really covered it on the show, because I've never really... Now, let me make this clear. I have, like, if I had to, you know, place all my chips on red or black, I would put them on red, being that there is something that meets the description of Bigfoot that is out there, or at least was out there, because cultures all across the world, they may have different names for it, but as far as recorded history goes, people have been talking about this thing. So they're obviously not talking about nothing at all. So I do believe that there's got to be something out there. But at the same time, every time somebody comes out like, oh, here's the smoking gun, here's like the Patterson footage, for example, it's like, okay, that's clearly a guy in a monkey suit walking around. You can see the sole of the shoes. You know, and it's just like, I just feel like there's a lot of bad representation for the case of Bigfoot out there. But I would imagine and I hear it on your show from time to time, you know, you can actually represent it in a positive way. So what are some of the more, let's just tee it off here. you know, what are some of the more fascinating finds, whether archaeological or circumstantial or whatever, that, you know, actually proves the case of a Sasquatch or a Bigfoot or a Yeti or whatever you want to call it?
Well, when it comes to Bigfoot or Sasquatch, I prefer Sasquatch, even though that is its own kind of a amalgamation or appropriation of Native American terms that were used originally for this concept. I nonetheless think that although I will tread carefully and say that this is something that remains unproven, and again, hearkening back to what my friend the epidemiologist who I referenced earlier had said, that there can be something that there can be a lot of data in support of or evidence for, but which remains unproven for very distinctive reasons and therefore scientifically does not exist. Sasquatch exists in that paradigm. The problem, I think, is that with the accumulation of anecdotal evidence, however reliable or unreliable anecdotal evidence may be, at the end of the day, there must be something to it. I'm not the only person by any means who has said this. In fact, someone who I respected greatly, the late John Napier, who was a primatologist with the Smithsonian Institute, went into it fairly skeptically and came away after an analysis of Sasquatch, the literature, the anthropological aspects, personal analysis of things like the Patterson-Gimlin film. He came away from this discussion and went, his own assessment of the phenomena and said, look, you know, it may not be all it's cracked up to be, but I could not imagine that there would be nothing to all this. All of this is just people mistaking things or making things up. And many have said, look, there's got to be something at the end of the day, but it's also something that is enigmatic enough that there has been a lot of mythology built onto it in the modern sense of things. So where I come into all of this is, and I'll admit from the outset, I've had an interest in this subject since I was about 5 years old. My mom and dad, they introduced me to books on this subject. I remember being in kindergarten and talking to my teachers about it. As I was learning to write and spell the English language, you know, I nonetheless was learning how to read with books on this subject. By the time I was in about third grade, some teachers took issue with that and actually called for a parent-teacher conference and said,
what?
We do not... Yeah, yeah.
What? And
Cortana, have I never told you this story?
No, I don't think you have.
My third grade teacher actually called a parent-teacher conference and told my parents, I don't approve of the kinds of things that you are having your child read. And as my lovely assistant Lauren knows, it wasn't just with that subject. It was also with, and she shares my fascination, by the way, with Sasquatch, but covers all this stuff. They also had an issue with the UFO stuff. They said, we think it's unhealthy, the kinds of things he's reading. And my mom and dad said, look, here's the thing. He reads, doesn't he?
Yeah, right? Like, at least he's reading.
And they kind of left it at that. Now, the teacher continued to assign me B grades on, maybe I just didn't do well enough. But again, I would think that, well, what's funny, I'll put it to you like this. She would give me a B and she would say, you know, you did a good job on this report, but you wrote about a subject that there's no scientific anything that backs it. But I went back recently and reread the papers, and I'd had an assistant teacher, Mrs. Redmond, and in the margins, she was writing letters to me in the margins. And Mrs. Redmond had written things like, did you see the program on Unsolved Mysteries the other night where they talked about, you should look into this? It's kind of fascinating because I look back now, and as a kid, I didn't understand what all was going on. And actually, one of my responses to her was, oh, yeah, I heard about something that some people said that they saw in the sky, but it sounds to me like they probably just saw the moon. I mean, it was so much like me today, because here's my assistant teacher who behind my teacher's back is writing little notes in the margin to me about, by the way, you should look into this. Have you heard about this? Do you know about this one? And I'm like, yeah, that probably wasn't actually a UFO. But the teacher is, you know, again, representative of the sort of consensus knowledge. We cannot allow that. And furthermore, if my students talk about it, we're not going to discuss that. So coming
so,
back to...
it just sounds like you've just been on a mission to prove that third grade teacher that these things are, that there is a scientific evidence to prove these said phenomena like Bigfoot.
Yeah, I think she would be happy to see how skeptically inclined I've become. But I think she also would be horrified to realize that her effort early on to try and she didn't do anything. She was a great teacher, but she did nothing to try and inspire me to be more scientifically inclined. She simply said, these subjects are not the kinds of things you need to be reading. Your parents shouldn't allow you to read these things. There was never any kind of a, well, here's why I don't think you should read these things. Here are things that with your interest or your aptitudes you should be looking. There was never any kind of, let's turn this in a positive way towards something else. It was just, no, you can't. No, it doesn't. No, it isn't. You know, stop.
Yeah.
And so
and little Micah was like, I'll show you.
Yeah,
I'll teach you to teach me.
And some people would say, well, this is the psychological root for Hanks's belief. And, well, that's the whole thing. I don't believe any of these things. I became a skeptic, ultimately. So coming back to Sasquatch, yes, I am willing to say that there is, and actually I've spoken with leading experts in the field of research who would contend the same thing. They say you can watch all these television shows with all these goofballs going out there in the woods and screaming, hollering, knocking on trees, doing all this stuff, setting squatch traps and all this. The reason they never find anything is because as researchers who have been involved with this for close to 50, 60 years will tell you, there is not a shred of physical proof that has ever been found. So why in the world would we waste our time studying something like this? Now, to understand that aspect of all this, we have to go all the way back to the colonial period. We have to go back to the period when, again, people from Europe were migrating into America and they were settling the lands further west. And one of the earliest accounts that comes from that period was by Elkanah Walker, who was a missionary who was with the Spokane Indians in 1840 or 50. And he wrote this correspondence where he wrote, you know, allow me to trouble you with some of their superstitions. And the superstitions of the Spokane that he talked about were, he said, a race of giants that were alleged to live on one of their large mountain peaks to the west. These mountain giants would come down in the night and they would steal fish from the trappings and things like this. He said they were also, according to the Native American legends among the Spokane, they were stealers of men. They would come, they would steal women and children and take them back to their villages. Well, he very clearly describes these things as mythologies. But what's fascinating is that these mythologies do begin to parallel things that we see that occur later. Now, I've been fascinated with the subject for a long time, as we've already established. But recently I picked up a copy of Daniel Loxton and Donald Prothero's, I'll go ahead and say, excellent book, Abominable Science. It's a skeptical book on cryptozoology. And I bought it because I really wanted to see what they had to say about all these subjects. And so it's a very necessary perspective they provide as skeptics, you know, reining in on some of the silliness that you see. And because I'm sorry, very good friends of mine even write blogs every day about how Bigfoot or Loch Ness Monster or whatever else are paranormal mystical phenomena, and that's why we don't have this physical evidence. And I'm like, guys, that very well may be the case, but if we begin thinking something so far out, that's not going to further our efforts to understand the possible physical representation of these phenomena. Now, here's the thing. When I get Prothero and Loxton's book, I'm thinking, well, I'm not only going to learn some things, but I'm also going to agree with a lot of what they've already written. Then we get to the chapter on Bigfoot. And I'm willing to go on record and say that it was one of the most poorly researched essays, that single chapter, on this subject that I've read, with complete respect to the authors. And let me tell you why I feel it was poorly researched. So, in the author's opinion, the idea that Sasquatch exists in Native American folklore is what they're borrowing their term. They said a cultural appropriation of the modern concept of Sasquatch being projected onto Native American legends that have nothing to do with a giant anthropomorphic ape-like creature.
Right.
Further, they say that there is no record of anything described like a giant ape-like creature that appears at all until 1967.
Aren't even apes in America, you know? Like, where would they get that description, you know what I mean? Like, there aren't apes in America, so, like, why would they even describe it as it's ape-like? No, it's just this big, fuzzy, human-looking thing that's just running around. Now, I was just musing over in my head a little bit on how, like, is Bigfoot a meme? Because all of these tribes seem to talk about these giant, hairy beings. Was it, like, one tribe might have saw him, and then the idea just penetrated throughout as one society started contacting the other? Or did each and every group of people actually have some encounter with this phenomena?
I think it's actually the former. Cortana. I think it's more likely that not all of the groups, if they all did have groups, it might have been in an earlier time. And that is, again, jumping into the paradigm of, hey, this creature might actually exist. Therefore, there would be a basis for an actual encounter with said creature. But in my opinion, especially in modern times, when you encounter, Southeastern First Nations bands that describe their own versions of Sasquatch, it seems highly unlikely that they would have had actual encounters with the same sorts of things. Now, maybe they did. I don't know. But to me, in that regard, the idea of a cultural, mythological meme kind of phenomena seems more likely. But now, speaking specifically about the Northwestern tribes, the Pacific Northwestern tribes of North America, we find some interesting things, because coming back to the idea of this being cultural appropriation, that really got stuck in my craw. And further, the idea that, and again, not to make this a political debate, but these days often you see this in anthropology, and I think it's my experience in archaeology and anthropology that caused me to take issue with that, because often unpopular ideas in archaeology and anthropology, if they are not in line with consensus views, they are deemed inappropriate or racist even. And I spoke recently with a brilliant guy, Dr. Bradley Lepper with the Ohio History Connection. When I asked him about ancient astronaut theories, he said, he said very carefully, and again, I really respect people who are so careful in the way that they use this terminology. He said, I think, and it is a strong term, but I think it applies here, and so I'll use it. I think at worst, some of the ancient astronaut theory is racist in the sense that it says these people couldn't have done this. It mm-hmm. must have been aliens that did it. You know, he articulated it in a very careful, responsible way. But there are many, especially young, highly politically motivated commentators in the subculture of anthropology that they just want to lob racist napalms, and everything that they disagree with is racist, racist.
Yeah.
That's become a real problem, because sadly, their argument that everything is racist actually in many instances could paradoxically take away from some of the values and traditions of the First Nations people, which is actually more of an affront against their culture than the great mission of the modern archaeologists, who would call everybody racist for doubting certain consensus opinions. So in the context of Sasquatch, again, being aware of some of those problems in modern archaeology, and being someone, by the way, at the end of the day, who abhors racism on all fronts, when I see people saying, well, you guys, you First Nations people, and your beliefs and your traditions having to do with Sasquatch, this couldn't have to do with anything that actually exists, even if you say it does. Once again, what's worse? The idea of someone calling it cultural appropriation, or people being told, your beliefs and your value systems have no relevance to us, the great enlightened arrivers. So, again, that's the problem I have, is those who would call these ideas racist actually are the very ones who are saying, the Native Americans, we don't take seriously what they actually have to say. So in this chapter in the book, they actually make the argument that, well, the idea of this anthropomorphic ape-like creature doesn't appear until 1957. And by the way, again, I just want to be clear. I still give it an excellent grade because it's a well-written book. I just really disagree with the interpretations of the two authors there. But they cite a particular article from 1943 or 4 that appeared in the Maclean's Magazine in Canada, written by J.W. Burns. And it was entitled Introducing British Columbia's Hairy Giants. And they said, again, as John Green, the Sasquatch expert, will acknowledge, this article refers to explicitly large people, not any kind of giant monster, not anything with animalistic traits, just large people. And the hair covering, the being large and hairy, is referring to hair coming off of the head and often falling to the waist. Well, so I went back to this quote-unquote primary source, this article. I don't know that really historically speaking, we would call that a primary source. But again, I'm saying that this is the first written document that's being referenced and interpreted in this book, and I felt was being misinterpreted. And in fact, I thought that there was a lot of liberty being taken by the authors with the way that they were reporting on what was being described. They were saying, essentially, these Native Americans are saying that large Native Americans existed that looked just like them, didn't have hair all over their bodies, anything like that. Well, so you go back to J.W. Burns' original article, and you actually read it. In J.W. Burns' piece, there is a correspondence that is printed verbatim by a man named Mr. William Point, who, along with his girlfriend, at a like a hop picking event, like a kind of a potluck, kind of a picnic, had said that he and his girlfriend were walking down this railroad track, and they actually observed one of these objects, creatures rather, coming toward them. In the distance, they couldn't make out that it was anything but a large man, but as it got closer, they said that the arms hung much longer than an average human, probably down below the knee. They said it was covered in hair all over its body like the bear. Now, that pretty explicitly, to me, sounds like hair that grows all over the body, not just long hair coming from the head falling to the waist. They said that in addition to being covered all over the body like in hair like the bear, that it walked with a hunched gait, and that they said that it's there was no hair on the face, but that it had a broad nose that covered almost the entire width of the face, which gave it a very frightening appearance. Now,
a werebear.
I couldn't imagine a better description of a large, upright, walking, gorilla-like creature.
Yeah.
But the problem is that, again, the authors of the book, noble though intent they had tried to be with saying that, hey, this meme of the large ape-like creature doesn't appear until the 1950s, that's simply wrong. It was being described, and furthermore, I went back earlier. Archival newspaper research will show you that going back all the way to 1924, the Seattle Times published an article that was titled "Clue to Gorilla Men at Ape Canyon May Be in Lost Race of Giants." And
sounds then they, like some of my exes.
Ha! Well, but the interesting thing is that, again, the Seattle Times in the 1920s was already publishing articles making reference to these large creatures being similar to gorillas in appearance. So the idea that this gorilla-like creature, that this doesn't arrive in the public zeitgeist of North America until the 1950s, around 1956 or 57, that's simply wrong. That had been a descriptor in relation to all this going back at least to the 1920s in the popular press. Now, what's significant about that is the fact that, again, quoting people who had, I think there was a man named Yost Tagley who was quoted in the 1924 article from the Seattle Times. He says, listen, among the Clallam and many other Northwestern Native American tribes, we have known about this other group. And again, his terminology for the time, this other group of Indians. They were called the Siatic or the Siato. We thought they were extinct because they haven't been seen for 15 years. But, and then they begin to reference this incident that allegedly occurred at Ape Canyon around that time, where a group of miners were said to have been attacked by these things. And he says, listen, we've known about them for forever. But
they're just here. They're a fact of life.
Yeah, but unfortunately, the newcomers, i.e., again, Europeans who are migrating into this area, the colonists and the new arrivals, they treat these things as they are purely myth, myth and superstition. So, again, a lot of the modern writing on this subject that makes the very clear, damning case that this is all just silliness, it actually cherry picks. It takes extreme leaps of logic, and it takes extreme. And again, many would say, how can you take a leap of logic against an idea so crazy as Sasquatch? Well, if you don't understand the actual history of the idea and you are writing your own history around the facts and you're cherry picking horribly, yeah, I would say that you're taking leaps of logic. I'm not trying to argue even that the creature exists. I'm saying that the history is being rewritten in front of our eyes, and yet Columbia Yes. University Press is publishing that as though this is the be-all, end-all, only interpretation of what this possibly could be, when in fact I don't think it's the best representation of the facts at all. That led me to looking into some of the scientific arguments and even interviewing 94-year-old Peter Byrne, who has spent decades studying this phenomena, who also told me, he said, look, again, I believe that there is something to it, like so many others who have put time, effort, and energy into this, but I've never found a shred of physical evidence in the form of anything that's genetic, anything in terms of a bone, anything in terms of, anything that is a physical trace of this creature, apart from footprint castings that at least on three occasions in like 40 years, I think were legitimate.
Right. And
so what are we left with? I mean,
Yeah. And then there's a couple of other more scientific discoveries or at least the reports. One thing I want to get into is the jawbone off the coast of Denisovan jawbone that was found off the coast of Taiwan. And then also, this whole through the Freedom of Documentation Act, this FBI file where they're, you know, talking about looking into Bigfoot hair samples, which adds a little more credence to the story. But real quick, Hobbs, we do have to take a commercial break. This will be the last and final break. So, ladies and gentlemen, you are listening to Shift Happens here for the Fringe FM. I'm your host, Gigi. Along with my co-host, Cortana, we're here with Micah Hanks from the Graylian Report, and we'll be back in just a few short minutes. Don't go anywhere.
Truth? Are UFOs real? Are aliens visiting Earth? Are governments around the world hiding the biggest secret in history? We're UFO Seekers, official partner of The Fringe FM, and we're on a hunt for the truth. Join us as we investigate locations like Area 51 by subscribing on YouTube at youtube.com/UFO Seekers.
Are you intrigued by paranormal talk radio? You'll love the new Paranormal Radio app from TalkStream Live. You'll find a great selection of talk shows covering UFOs, ghosts, strange phenomena, and much more. Download the Paranormal Radio app now and start listening to the very best in paranormal talk entertainment, including the network you're listening to right now. The Paranormal Radio app, free in Google Play and the iOS App Store.
All right, man, this is Crow777, and you are listening to The Fringe FM.
So, you love talk radio? Then you'll love TalkStreamLive.com. TalkStream Live is always on, 24/7, with the best streaming talk shows. Find your favorite talkers and discover some new ones. It's free, readily available online or on mobile with any smartphone or tablet. Finding your favorite talk shows all in one place has gotten a whole lot easier. Just go to TalkStreamLive.com. Be sure to download the free apps from Google Play or the iTunes App Store.
Want to know what's on The Fringe FM? Check out our schedule at thefringe.fm.
Don't feed the archons. Feed ducks instead. And listen to Shift Happens on The Fringe FM. Fridays, 7 to 9 p.m. Pacific. Cortana out. Quack.
Okay, nurse, let's get this man to the ER stat.
Right away, doctor.
We see this every day. Heart attack or angina pain due to blocked and clogged arteries. Chelation can remove obstructions or blockages from arteries and help avoid painful and expensive surgery. Now there's Angioprim. It's a liquid oral chelation product that you take with juice. You start to feel the results fast. Angioprim increases blood flow all over the body, and that means more energy and strength to take on the day with less aches and pains. 60 years of research has gone into chelation. And Angioprim is the result, a safe and easy way to unblock your veins and arteries from buildup that slow circulation.
Paging Dr. Jones, please report to the emergency room right away.
Log on now for a special radio offer from Angioprim. That's angioprim.com/radio. A-N-G-I-O-P-R-I-M. Angioprim.com/radio or call 877-882-7221. That's 877-882-7221.
Live for 3 hours every Saturday night. It's a show that engages the mind, makes you think, and maybe even challenge what you think you know. Hi, I'm Jeremy Scott of Into the Paranormal, where we talk about topics that are anything but mainstream, somewhere between abnormal and paranormal. Bring an open mind and join us for Into the Paranormal. Live Saturdays at 6 p.m. Pacific, 9 p.m. Eastern on The Fringe FM.
KTLK Digital Broadcasting, TheFriends.fm, Napa Valley, California, Little Rock, Arkansas.
We'll be right back.
we're back. For the Fringe FM, this is Shift Happens. I'm your host, Gigi, along with my co-host, Cortana. And we're here tonight with Micah Hanks. And before
he's being quite amusing right now.
Yeah, if you guys only had our video feed. So before we, Hobbs, get back into discussion of tonight, real quick, I did want to mention, so Kat in the chat room, she's out there in Los Angeles, and Brad's over there in San Clemente, about an hour south, and they're both talking about an earthquake that's happened since the show started, somewhere between a 7 and a 7.1, and I think that's
where?
In Los Angeles, and apparently Brad felt it all the way down in San Clemente, and I guess it's all over the news right now over there. In 7.1, that's a pretty, you know, that's a pretty substantial earthquake. So, yeah, back when it was happening, Kat was like, earthquake, earthquake now, in the chat room, and so it must have been pretty gnarly. So I think that's a Shift Happens first, as far as the audience goes. I don't think we've ever had an audience member go through an earthquake during one of our shows. So
it says it was a magnitude 6.4 earthquake 11 miles from Ridgecrest, California. So it looks between Death Valley National Park and Los Angeles. So if Los Angeles was feeling it, well, wow, because people all the way up in Bakersfield and Fresno might feel it.
Yeah. And then,
interesting.
And Brad's down in San Clemente, which is an hour south of Los Angeles from there. So that's even crazier. That must have been a pretty big one. So there's that. Also, you know what? I don't think we're gonna have time to open up the phone lines tonight. I really don't think so. So we still have that last copy to give away of Billy Carson's book. Yeah, I know. Oh, by the way, Mary White, your copy is coming your way. Eric, I'll give it to you next time I see you. Daryl, I'll send yours out soon too. All right, there we go. Oh, also, t-shirts. I might have mentioned this a few weeks ago. Long, complicated story. Most companies are not willing to print it the way we want to because it might damage their machine. We did find one company recently, though, so they're actually about to be made. So Sandra and Dan, we will be giving those shirts out to you sooner than never. Sooner
Leave it to us to never. Find the most difficult to print that would break a machine logo.
Yeah, apparently the one, you know, the method that is required to use to get the achieved look is called direct to garment or whatever, and most companies will do it in any color shirt except for black, which is, of course, what our shirts need to be.
Yeah.
But I found one company that either they don't recognize the danger of it or they've just accepted the risk, whatever. I didn't question it. Like, oh, you do it? Okay. So so we'll see how that goes. Hopefully the machines don't break on us. But anyway, so Micah, getting back to Hobbs, some of the Sasquatch talk. So you and both of these things, I was not aware of until we were talking earlier today. So let's get into this. I mean, it may or may not be directly related. It might not be direct evidence to what we call Sasquatch or Bigfoot, but it's certainly something just as mysterious, which is the Denisovan era jawbone that was found off of the coast of Taiwan, I believe that was. Am I correct on that?
You are correct. If it is Denisovan, whatever it is, it's very enigmatic. And what I'm referencing here is the Pinghu jawbone. There was a full, you know, paper that was written and published in the journal Nature about this. Now, again, a lot of people would feel that to try and bring this up in the context of anything related to Sasquatch does it a disservice. I would nonetheless maintain that it is relevant to the broader study of potential relic hominoids, and here is why. We have long heard this, I mean, it's been kind of a rally cry among the modern academic establishment who does not appreciate the insinuation that a large anthropoid ape could exist, you know, something along the lines of Sasquatch. They have said, you know, again, there is nothing in the fossil record that would, you know, support the existence of a creature like this. Now, those who would hear me saying that much would go, oh, God, Hanks is going to try and make the claim that the Pinghu hominid, you know, hominoid, you know, or the, rather the hominid jawbone is in some way related to Sasquatch. That actually is maybe not the case, perhaps even unlikely, although it is interesting. But here's the broader point that needs to be made, and why I say that it's related to that. We at one time, again, they would say that there's nothing in the fossil record. Well, you know, there also was never anything in the fossil record indicative of the Denisovans until they found it at Denisova
Cave.
A tooth
in a cave, right?
It was a tooth, and it was the very tip of a finger, which was destroyed in order to extract the mitochondrial DNA so as to be able to sequence the Denisovan genome. And that's the whole thing. Now we actually have another portion of a jaw that is believed to have belonged to a Denisovan, and there are some conjectures that the Pinghu jaw actually belonged to a Denisovan as well. So rather than saying it belongs to Sasquatch, it is more likely it belongs to Denisovans, but that is not even confirmed. What is confirmed is that this is a mystery hominid that existed at some point in the Pleistocene, the last epoch prior to the Holocene in which we now exist. This is basically the last ice age. It wouldn't have been older than 400,000 years, but some estimates place the Pinghu jaw fragment at being as recent as 10,000 years. Now, that is mind-numbingly incredible.
Yeah,
I'll tell you why. Here's the issue. We know that the Denisovans existed tens of thousands of years ago, maybe longer, but on the near side of in terms of how long they may have persisted. And we also, by the way, know that they, like Neanderthals, interbred with modern humans, Homo sapiens sapiens, because we are able to trace that in our mitochondrial DNA. And after sequencing the genome of the Neanderthal and the Denisovans, we know that they interbred with modern humans and that we can still see prevalence in modern human DNA in different areas that help us trace where the Denisovans migrated to and where they traveled. Where we find no actual fossil evidence, we absolutely are able to trace their footprints through genetic science, and that is fascinating. But then there are these interesting discoveries that have occurred in the last few years as well. Homo floresiensis, of course, on the island of Flores. Again, I'm going with the Latin taxonomical names here, but the Florens, the island of Florens, these beings, these hobbits, as they have been kind of referred to as. They were another distinctive Homo type, very small. Some have said that they were just, again, just a small group of people that may have been another recognized species. More interesting to me even was in the 1980s, a series of fossils that were recovered from the Red Deer Cave in the Yunnan province of China. And this is the what have appropriately been called the Red Deer Cave people. They are also described as being, in likelihood, a distinctive, different group, not just a cultural group, but actually distinctive from Homo sapiens sapiens. But they existed as recently as 11 to 12,000 years ago. That's,
happened 11 to 12,000 years ago? I wonder. Let's check that that core record there.
there were some interesting geological and climatological changes that were occurring around that time. But again, we're talking about the late Paleo-Indian, early Archaic period here in North America. That makes this group contemporaneous with the Clovis culture in North America. Culture, again, I would contend is identified by the tools that they created, not so much by, again, a cultural group as far as a group that actually migrates into the continent all at once, and that they are represented genetically and otherwise as being one singular culture. In likelihood, and many archaeologists are coming to agreement on this point, North America was probably inhabited for thousands of years before what we identify as the Clovis tools. The Clovis points, the fluted blades and whatnot that we identify with the Clovis culture before that became a thing. Now, the idea that another culture might have introduced that technology and that dispersed among existent populations is still something that's in debate. What does all this have to do with Sasquatch? If the Red Deer Cave people are a distinct, separate Homo group that coincided with the Clovis but existed in parts of China, and if the Pinghu jawbone does represent something that on the nearer side of probability could have been within 10,000 years ago, well, I mean, we're looking at, again, non-Homo sapiens sapiens hominids that have existed far more recently than most people are aware of or would ever have guessed.
Well, I also want to interject something, too,
please.
Is that humanity, because of these other species of humans that were much taller than what humans were, you know, a few thousand years ago, maybe more than a few thousand years ago. Of course, it seems like there's just this cultural or genetic memory that somehow our human bloodline seems to remember a time when they also lived side by side, and we probably even have, you know, instincts, epigenetic instincts that kind of play into this cultural memory of living amongst giants or living amongst little people.
You do hear a lot of that, and actually something that comes to mind among the Aleut and the Inuit, of the Northwest, they describe that, you know, and again, this is stepping over into their mythology, but what they wrote, and forgive me, the name of the monograph that in which this was published slips my mind, but I could find it and share that at a later time. But they essentially described in their cultural origin stories that they say when we arrived from the first land. Now, again, naturally where our mind goes is in the direction of what the preponderance of the modern genomic data does say, which is that people came across the Beringia land bridge from Asia. And I don't dispute that, by the way. Again, you cannot dispute all of the evidence. And the fact that, of course, that we've got all of there, I think there's some 42 different haplogroups. But again, the primary first haplogroups that were discovered, A, B, C, and D, I believe. Again, we find haplogroups A, C, and D among the Northwest, or not just the Northwestern, I mean, the North and I think some of the South American Native American Indian tribes. You find B also. I'm sorry, you do not find B in Eurasia where they are believed to have come from, but you do find A, C, and D, again, in Siberia, in the area, in the direction in which they came. Yes, haplogroups A through D you do find in the Americas. So, anyway, trying to keep this all together. I'm not a genetic expert. I read a lot. So keeping this all together and going off memory, I like to play this game when I go out with friends for drinks. They all get to use their Google. I have to go from memory.
Yeah. Well, I think that's only fair because your brain just simply operates at a higher capacity than most people. And what's even more amazing about that is you don't sleep at all. So it's really.
I take catnap standing up. Mostly when other people are talking. No,
dude,
I'm kidding.
I have seen Hobbs. Micah actually take a nap while doing a handstand before. Only a 4-minute nap, but it was pretty something to witness.
So refreshed.
There's something about sleeping in a handstand that really, you know, just rejuvenates you in a totally different way.
The blood, again, rushes to the head, therefore stimulating the eyes, ears, nose, and throat, and the brain, of course. And it's absolutely helpful. I mean, it's almost like a full night's sleep, if only in a pinch. But you got to find the right angle so that you don't fall over. Otherwise, you injure yourself and others standing nearby.
It's very important when searching for angles that you want blood to rush through.
Yes, yeah, Cortana.
And, the 15-piece home kit of the handstand sleep kit by Micah Hanks will be available just in time for Christmas this year. So stay tuned for that, folks. Now, so real quick, we've only got a few minutes left. Now that we're starting to find, and we've been finding these other spinoffs or whatever you want to call it, other not human-like people that were not Homo sapiens sapiens. They're a little bit removed from us, but as early as 10,000 years ago. Well, now it kind of makes me possibly right. But now it kind of makes me wonder. And then also they found, like we roughly mentioned earlier, there's been very hobbit like people we found. Mm-hmm. And I remember there was one case in particular where it wasn't even more than 3.5 feet. Like it was a tiny little thing. It had an extra couple of ribs. And the wear and tear in the knees showed that it must have been at least 8 years old. Yet it's this tiny little thing. I think it was found in South America.
Is it the little serious little dude that
you're talking about? Not the Atacama humanoid.
Oh, wait, actually.
Which I believe, again, is in
not that one.
Human.
Not that one. There's another one. Actually, I might be getting my facts mixed up. That was the one with the extra ribs, right? But the one I'm talking about, it had knee wear and tear that was that's
like
beside
this
the point
walked and talked and
yeah this thing was
well, the knee wear would seem to indicate that it wasn't a youthful individual, that it was small but it was older, and that therefore that there was wear on the knees from use, from walk, right?
Yeah, like, and this thing was about half the size of an 8-year-old. So, yeah. So yeah, that's kind of, but anyway, to get back to the point, so whether they were small or big, whatever, there's other, you know, humanoid, like, kind of like IPD has said a couple of times in the chat room. He says, hominid. And I would reply to that, Hobbs. So, but if we're finding, you know, hominids that are not exactly Homo sapiens sapiens, potentially as early as 10,000 years, now let's think about this. What about, you know, we've got these sites like Göbekli Tepe that's going back to 12,400. So what if, and you know, in a lot of these ancient megalithic structures, if you look at, you know, John Anthony West and Robert Bevall and Robert Schock and their opinions of the datings of the pyramids, very, you know, it seems like they might very well be just as old as Göbekli Tepe. And if you look at the star alignments, probably maybe 1,000, 2,000 years older. Or as Jaws would say, he thinks it goes back to 36,000. But, you know, who knows? But either way, what if, because these, you know, we still don't really understand how these structures were built, because we don't even know how we would go about building them. They seem to have these other techniques that we don't have today. So what if maybe they were built, just a random idea, what if they were built by one of these other offshoots of, you know, maybe not Homo sapiens sapiens, but what if some of these other ones that we're finding that were still around, around the time of those buildings, you know, maybe they just died off, but maybe they had their own ways of building things, and maybe some of these structures were built by someone else, not necessarily aliens, but other Earth life forms that are closely related to us. Just kind of an idea that kind of just popped into my head.
Well, you know, again, Andrew Collins, who I unfortunately have not corresponded with enough, although I met him a few years ago, and I, again, full disclosure, I actually have had the pleasure of being able to narrate two of his audiobooks published by Inner Traditions Books. One of those was called The Cygnus Key. And then more recently, he co-authored a book with, as in Cygnus, the Celestial Swan.
It's dead. Yeah, of course.
And,
in Duck News.
And then also, and I know we're about to wrap up here, so very briefly, my friend Dr. Greg Little also co-authored a book with Andy called Denisovan Origins. But to summarize briefly, that's basically, Gigi, what they contend is that they believe that the structures at Göbekli Tepe and certain other sites can be traced back to Denisovan influence, whether or not directly through the Denisovans. It very well may have been cultural traditions passed down, because again,
the interbreeding, cultures.
Well, we know that the Denisovans and the Neanderthal interbred with modern Homo sapiens sapiens, and that perhaps that influence was carried down. And this comes back to something you said, Cortana, the traditions that were passed down through oral traditions, you know. And I think you use the term epigenetic in reference to that. But again, you know, the idea that concepts are passed down through cultures over time, great periods of time, and that some of these things may actually be requisite or rather represented at these ancient cultural sites like Göbekli Tepe. I will say this, and I was merely the narrator on those projects, but to give you my anthropological perspective on them, highly speculative though that is, at times also it becomes almost, you know, membrane thin, some of the conjectures. But nonetheless, I think that there are some really interesting points raised, and I really actually like some of the questions that Andrew Collins asks about that, and of course Dr. Greg Little. They actually raise some incredibly meaningful questions about understanding human lineages and also the construction of some of these ancient ceremonial sites and whether or not, indeed, they may have had something to do with earlier hominid ancestry and some of our cousins like the Denisovans and the Neanderthals. It is indeed food for thought.
Yeah, it really is some food for thought, and I never really had that food to think on until
delicious.
Today. So there you go. Now, we have to run right this very now, real quick, in 20 seconds or less. Where can everybody keep up with Micah Hanks and all the various podcasts you do and all of your goodness?
It's easy. Micah Hanks. My name, Micah, M-I-C-A-H. Hanks, like the actor Tom. MicahHanks.com. You can find all my podcasts and also blog posts about things we haven't even broached tonight, like all my missing persons FOIA request inquiries, which are ongoing.
Yeah, and Hobbs. So, yeah, I think we should definitely do a B-side with you sometime soon so we can continue this conversation and not have to take breaks, and we can just go for 2 or 3 hours straight.
Anytime, yeah, let's do it.
Until then, ladies and gentlemen, this has been Shit That Happens Here for the Fringe FM. The show is hosted and produced by yours truly and Cortana as well. Associate producer is Brad Harris. You can follow him on Twitter at @ADSBradHarris. Special shout out to Darren McClure. You can follow him on Twitter at Neon Surfer. Also, special shout out to Eric Awakening Man. And of course, Dennis Koch for all of his promotional goodness that he does. And as always, Hobbs, all blames and faults go to Fran. That's right. Hashtag Fran's fault. All right, thanks for tuning in, guys. But don't go too far, because coming up next, right here on the Fringe FM, is Lighting the Void with Joe Roop. All right, guys, we'll see you next week. But also, don't forget, we have a live B-side episode coming up this Sunday with JP from Inflammatory Talk. All right, folks, take care.
Don't be the Archons. Be ducks instead.
Duck up.